This is Jesuit Father Robert McTague, your daily host of The Catholic Current. Have I got a deal for you? I'd like to send you an autographed copy of my latest book, Christendom Lost and Found. We're making it available to anyone who can donate to the Station of the Cross at the rate of just a dollar a day. Let's make this happen. Go to thestationofthecross.com to support our spring appeal. Be sure to type free book in the notes section when you make your donation. May God bless your generosity.
This is The Catholic Current with Father Robert McTague.
There are people who are waking up and they look at the wreckage of the past 3 years and said, I can't be part of business as usual anymore. And then they ask, now what? And I say the now what is the same as always. It's a profound conversion to Christ.
The consequences of that worldview is becoming clear. All this new speak, all these pronouns, these are just the latest translation of the ancient hiss of the serpent. Ye shall be as gods.
Praise be Jesus Christ. This is Father Robert McTague of the Society of Jesus, your daily host for The Catholic Current, where we bring Christ to the world and the world to Christ. You're listening to us from the Station of the Cross Studios, your local radio station, and the iCatholic Radio mobile app, where we proclaim the fullness of truth with clarity and charity. As always, let's start with prayer. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Almighty God, through the intercession of St. Ignatius Loyola, we ask that you pour forth your Holy Spirit upon us, a spirit of discernment, that we may hear your voice and obey your commands. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, you know, here at The Catholic Current, we always offer a family-friendly show. Sometimes we have frank and candid conversations about difficult topics. This is one of them. Please listen accordingly. Well, friends, I was talking to some parents recently, and the kids are of an age where they're getting out of the house on their own, and they have to talk about stranger danger and being aware of shady characters and coming to terms with the fact that we live in a world where not everyone wishes you well. We want to talk today about protecting your family members from an aggressive form of the sexual revolution, protecting your family from the top five gay myths. That's a special report prepared by the Ruth Institute. The author is the head of the Ruth Institute, and she's a friend of the show and a beloved guest of the show as well. Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, welcome back to The Catholic Current.
Thanks for having me, Father. I'm glad to come talk with you about this.
Dr. Morris, we have to be blunt. Why are you and I such haters?
Yeah. Well, because somebody benefits from pinning that kind of label on us. They're hoping we'll be quiet. They're hoping that we will be quiet, okay? And so when you're trying to drive an ideological agenda that doesn't work with facts and reason and evidence, your best bet is to shut up your opponents, right? Right. And so that's part of the strategy and tactics of the people to bring forward this really irrational ideology.
Right. And because a lot of people really are decent people with, ordinary human moral sensitivities, the thought of being called, a hater or a racist or a something phobe, kind of stops you in your track. And I say, wait, am I the bad guy here? And that does silence people. But the work of the Ruth Institute, which I've always admired very greatly, is the sexual revolution of the past 55, 60 years has racked up a terrible body count, damaged family, society, and souls. And you've been dealing with the casualties of that war, and not only hearing heartbreak stories, but helping them to find healing in light of the truth, which ultimately isn't my truth or your truth, but God's truth. In your book, you say that there's a basic myth which underlines the five, what you call the most prominent gay myths. So let's get a little bit of background, and then we'll go into myth number one.
Sure. Yeah, the way I would lay it out is this. There's a claim out there that we're all supposed to believe, and that is that sexual orientation is an innate, immutable characteristic, meaning people are born that way, okay? Mm-hmm. That your sexual orientation is something you're born with. The reason that point is so important is because if you can convince people of that, and particularly if you can convince the courts of that, then all of the legal apparatus that was created to assist African Americans to overcome the legacy of discrimination and slavery and so on, all of those legal tools can be pressed into service to protect homosexual activity, okay? And so basically what they're trying to do is convince you that gay is like black. And mm-hmm. the fact is gay is nothing like black, mm-hmm. And so getting that point straight, that is what this is all about. I think it helps people to see what's at stake and kind of the fundamental problem with it. Not to mention the fact that Black people despise this claim, right? I mean, Black people, and I have, you know, talked to numerous Black people who say this to you, you know, come on, you can see that I'm Black from across the street. In no way is it like being gay.
Friends, we're speaking today with Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute. We're talking about five ways to protect your family. Now, and myth number one, you say that sexual orientation can be easily and scientifically defined. So, you know, it's kind of the variation of the born that way, which I think is an argument that doesn't work because, you know, you might be born with a predisposition towards, you know, an allergy to shellfish. That doesn't mean that mollusks are good for you. So let's start with that myth number one. Now, remember, science is our friend, Dr. Morse. If the last 3 years have taught us anything, it's the value of following the science, capital T, capital S. So the claim is sexual orientation can be easily and scientifically defined. So, and if you deny that, somehow you hate science. So fill us in on that, please.
Here's the thing. This is something that is never actually stated, okay, Father? Nobody goes around saying, people say people are born gay. That you hear people say. But the truth is that sexual orientation, what is called sexual orientation, is a complicated mass of traits, behaviors, thoughts, feelings, self-identification, philosophical commitments, and so on. It's not one thing, okay? And the people who actually study it scientifically, who attempt to study, who attempt to understand, you know, why do some people behave this way and other people do not, people who study it are well aware that it is a multifaceted reality, you know. And so in order to there actually isn't one scientific definition of gay. There really isn't, you know, and people, you know, people act like, well, I know what a gay person is and he knows what a gay person is. But, you know, if you really want to study it and ask who counts as being part of this category and who does not count, you have to ask some very specific questions. And the answers to those questions do not always overlap, you know. Right. And for example, I think most people have an image of a gay person as being somebody who is incapable of having sexual relations with a person of the opposite sex, or is not attracted to, or doesn't want to, or wait a second, already it's unraveling, you know, that it's more than one thing. Okay. So some of the questions I ask would be, are you attracted to people of the same sex as yourself? Do you identify as gay or lesbian? Have you ever had sex with a person of the same sex? Have you had sex exclusively with partners of the same sex? See, so all of those things are a little bit different when you get down to it, and they don't perfectly overlap.
See, I find this so interesting because in the conversations I've had with folks, it's supposed to be so obvious that if you don't see it as obvious, you're just being obtuse. And and clearly there must be something wrong with you. So if the real science is we're treading on very complicated grounds, and you know, and even so you say yes to all that, isn't it pretty obvious by the way of the design of human bodies as male and female that where male and female are meant for each other? I mean, if you're going to talk about the science, isn't that a good scientific place to start with, something obvious?
Yes. And that's what's so interesting about this whole thing, that we are now to the point where the difference between male and female is no longer obvious, right? To the people who have really drunk the Kool-Aid, you know, and I'm going to just say that, you know, the people who are, you know, who are setting aside nature for their own purposes, okay? Once you go down the path of setting aside nature for your own purposes, natural truth, scientific, what you could, dare we call it, scientific truth, once you're setting it aside for your own purposes, and you continue to be committed to that in spite of the accumulation of evidence, right, you're going to end up in some pretty strange places. So now we're to the point where the most progressive thing to believe is that I can't tell the difference between a man and a woman. Male and female is socially constructed. That's what we're supposed to believe now. Okay. And part of the groundwork for that is to say, gee, I can't tell the difference between having sex with a person of my same sex or having sex with a person of the opposite sex. It all looks the same to me, produces orgasm, produces good feelings sometimes. It's all the same. I can't tell the difference, right? Well, the fact is there are multiple profound differences, right? And going back a step further is, gosh, I can't tell the difference between a sexual act that accidentally doesn't produce progeny and a sexual act that I have deliberately sterilized. I can't tell the difference. There's nothing intrinsically procreative in the nature of the sexual act. There's nothing special about the procreative male-female sexual activity, that it needs to be addressed differently and dealt with differently socially, you know, that there's something right. special about male-female. You know, we wiped that out with the pill, basically, you know, and the right. idea yeah. that as a society, we want sex to be sterile. So once sex is sterile, right. okay, that's the big move.
When I was teaching medical ethics, I said, once you separate sexuality from fertility, once you separate sexuality and fertility from natural marriage, then there are no non-arbitrary lines. There are no barriers or boundaries. It's just all silly putty for the human will. And boy, I don't trust the human will because we're all sinners. Friends, when we come back, we're going to continue our conversation with Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute. We're talking about 5 ways to protect your family. This is a mature topic. If you've got young ears with you, you might want to wait and grab this on the podcast version. Remember, our rallying cry here at the Catholic Current is Christus Mundo, Mundus Christo, bringing Christ to the world and the world to Christ. We do it because our Lord says so, for the greater glory of God, the love of our neighbor, and the salvation of our own soul. After the broadcast today, go to thestationofthecross.com, get our resources list, download our audio as podcast. Take this to your family and friends. Together, we'll take it to the whole world. Back in 2 minutes. Stay with us. This is Jesuit Father Robert McTagg, your daily host of the Catholic Current. Join me on Tuesday at 5 p.m. Eastern to welcome back Matt Archbold of Creative Minority Report. Our topic will be, and guess who else hates Catholics? The answer may surprise you. Hear it all in the Catholic Current on Tuesday at 5 p.m. Eastern, coming to you from the Station of the Cross on the iCatholic Radio mobile app.
You're listening to The Catholic Current with Father Robert Matej from the Station of the Cross Catholic Media Network. Stay connected with the show, our guests, and topics by following the show on Twitter and Gab. Just search for The Catholic Current.
Praise be Jesus Christ. This is Father Robert McTagg of the Society of Jesus, your daily host for the Catholic Current, where we bring Christ to the world and the world to Christ. You're listening to us from the Station of the Cross Studios, your local radio station, and the iCatholic Radio mobile app, where we proclaim the fullness of truth with clarity and charity. We're talking with Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute. We're talking about a new study prepared by her called Protecting Your Family from the Top 5 Gay Myths. It's a free download. We're going to provide that link. You know, friends, we always have a family-friendly show here at the Catholic Current. Today's topic is on the mature side. So if you're listening with young ears in your company, you might want to wait and grab the audio on the podcast platform. Dr. Morse, we've been talking about that generic myth that sexual orientation is very easily defined. It's something that you can just know as an earliest possible memory. But you've shown that as you dig deeper, it's more complicated than that. And what used to be the natural guidelines of male is obviously male, female is obviously female, and male and female are obviously made for each other. Those guidelines, those rails are being erased before our very eyes. So we have to keep arguing for the obvious, which I find boggling at this point in our cultural development. But let's jump in with myth number 2. People are simply born that way. You're either right. born completely gay or you're born completely straight. And again, the idea is
if you're born that way, that's not changeable. The irony, of course, is that male or female, you would think you're not only born that way, you were conceived that way. But right, somehow right. That's up for grabs. So it's kind of a, you know, a tails I win, heads you lose sort of thing, isn't it?
Yes. And this is one of the ironies of the whole thing, that the thing that you really are born with, which is your sexual identity as male or female, that is said to be mutable and changeable at the sign of your will, you know. But sexual orientation, which is a whole complex of things, of thoughts and feelings and the meaning you assign to them, where you have daily choices about how to respond to your feelings and what actions to take and how to think of yourself and how to identify yourself. You have daily choices about that matter. That's fixed, set in stone, can't change it, completely immutable. So we've really kind of turned things on their heads. And no doubt this is contributing to why people are so unhappy and confused and looking for answers and things like that. It's really part of this amount of obfuscation, this amount of confusion. It's like we're walking through a cloud of dust all the time. People are throwing dust in our faces and so you can't see what's going on. Well, naturally your eyes burn when that's going on.
Right. And this is where it becomes so frustrating, because it's like trying to play chess with someone who rewrites the rules whenever it's their turn. That becomes exhausting. But what's the strategy behind that you're born that way, full stop? Any other questions? You're a hater. Why do they insist on that?
So this is part of what I said in the first segment, Father, that they want to use the anti-discrimination apparatus that was created to help Black people, right? And so you being Black is not something you choose. Being Black is a fact. And if people are discriminating against you, there are rules about what people are allowed to do and not do around that, okay? And so if they can prove that being gay is somehow like being Black, then their certain parts of their behaviors are going to be protected. And that is what that's been the strategy all along, honestly. And so to look at it this way, to see it Black is a trait, 100% genetic. You know, you can tell immediately if a person's Black or not. Mm-hmm. I mean, of course, mixed race people provide some kind of, you know, confusion about that. But the point is, you know, that skin color and other secondary traits are easily visible and not changeable. And there's no moral significance to it. You didn't choose it, you know. Mm-hmm. Whereas your sexual conduct is completely chosen, right? I mean, you have all kinds of feelings. And the idea that you're allowed to act on any feeling that you have thoughtlessly, that can't be right. You know, that can't be true. And when you put it that boldly, of course, everyone would deny that that's the case. But in point of fact, what they're trying to say is that they want to have protection for their realm of sexual activity. And the way they're going about doing that is to say, you're discriminating against me on the basis of a immutable trait. Well, so now if I can turn around and say, well, look, nobody's born gay. No, you know, this is that. That's not how it works, you know. We can show you the genetic research. If we can show you the research from studies of identical twins, you know, if we can look at that type of evidence and say, well, look, people aren't born gay. What does that do to your argument? Well, they're pretty touchy about that argument, about that kind of evidence. And so that kind of tells you that they think it's significant, right?
Right.
That you can show that it's not true. I cite this study that came out a few years ago. It was a very big study of the human genome. And basically, the people who did the work had to admit that there was there's no gay gene. They had to admit that there's no gay gene. And so they're all, you know, kind of falling over themselves to say, but still, you know, we don't want people to get the wrong idea and, you know, so on and so forth. But I think the important point to see is that you may have a genetic predisposition to something, this, that, or mm-hmm. the other thing, a sexual attraction or anything else. You may have a genetic predisposition to something. That doesn't mean that you are genetically determined to act in a particular way and to view that thing in a particular way, to have your political and social allegiances aligned in a certain way. None of that is foreordained, you know, and that's what they want to obscure. You know, the fact right. that young person who experiences same-sex attraction does not have to be part of the gay community. And they can make all kinds of decisions about what to do, not do, think, not think. And the idea that you're born that way undermines the questioning young person who's trying to figure out who they are, you know. And right. in our little book, my ebook here that we're giving out, that you very kindly linked at your site there and that we give away at the Ruth Institute site, in the ebook we have several stories of people who have, in one way or another, through their lives, proven that these myths really are myths, you know. Why would you end up with a gay identity? Well, people talk about that they were looking for a friend. All I was looking for was friendship. That's an astonishing thing for a man to say in his 60s, that's all he was really looking for was friendship. And he thought that being part of the homosexual community was the way to do that. You know, that's sad. That's sad.
Well, and it's also politically forbidden. Friends, we're speaking today with Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute. We're talking about a new ebook that they've made available, and you can find it on our website, called Protecting Your Family from the Top 5 Gay Myths. What, you know, when you're raising toddlers to get along with people, you know, you say, use your words, you say, rather than hitting. Yeah. But name calling is a form of using words, but it's not very effective, or it's not very mature. So I think when the people that you've been disagreeing with, the advocates of sexual revolution that you've been struggling against for all these years, using their words doesn't really help them, because their arguments break down. So there has to be either emotional manipulation, or there has to be name calling, or you get the heavy hand of the state involved. I mean, if you and I say we're licensed therapists in say California, and we said, no, you weren't born that way. Do you want some help with that? We could lose our license, right?
That's
reparative therapy.
Mm-hmm. And that's part of the strategy also. I call that blocking the exit. You know, that the sexual revolutionaries have become very good at trying to keep people from exploring and fully embracing alternatives to their ideology. And this is one instance of it, you know, that you're going to ban therapy, even for adults. You know, they always talk about banning therapy for minors, but they want to ban it for everybody, you know. Adults who are licensed therapists, adults who are seeking help, they want to ban that talk therapy, you know, but it's comparable also to the proponents of abortion who want to block clinics, alternative. What am I trying to say?
The crisis pregnancy centers. Yeah.
Crisis pregnancy centers. That's right. The attack on crisis pregnancy center, which for a long time was simply rhetorical, but is now legal and physical. You know, they're bombing crisis pregnancy centers. Why? If you're in favor of women's choosing what they want, why would you ever do that? Well, they're doing that to block the exit. You know, if you have an unplanned pregnancy, your only choice is to have an abortion. You sit down, you shut up, you suck it up. And that's your choice, you know. And the thought that a woman might want support in maintaining her pregnancy and in keeping her child and in raising that child, and that there might be people willing to do that, that provides an exit from the mantra that sex is sterile. Sex is sterile. The right thing to do is to have sterile sex. You know, it provides relief from that. And that's what they don't want. And similarly, a young person who's struggling with their feelings of same-sex attraction, or maybe, you know, and this is an even more tragic one, Father, and I'm sure you've heard of this before, people who have been hit on by older people who are gay, and then the young person concludes, well, gosh, I must be gay. You know, that must be the truth about me. And if you have that experience and then you cement it with the story of, gosh, I guess I was born that way and this is the whole truth about me, well, that makes it difficult for that person to deal with it therapeutically, to deal with the fact that maybe they really aren't gay and didn't really like it or appreciate it very much, but this is their fate now somehow. you know, it's a very, I don't know, predestination kind of a theory. It's like Calvinism without grace.
Right, know? Right. I mean, what we have here is a kind of biological determinism that there yes. is something about you that you are absolutely hardwired to act in a way that your body was clearly not designed for, that you are absolutely required to act in a way that has no possibility of being naturally fruitful, that you are obliged to act in a way that doesn't contribute to the basic building block of society, which is, you know, man and woman, husband and wife, begetting children, rearing children. And contrary to what many, many bureaucrats and politicians are saying, the child does not belong to the state. The parents are not the vicars of the state. And what we're seeing now with the transgender movement is if mommy and daddy aren't keen with 10-year-old Sally wanting to become Sammy, the state will take the child away. I don't like the direction where this is heading. Friends, when we come back, we're going to continue our conversation with Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute. We're talking about the new ebook she just prepared for them called Five Ways to Protect Your Family from Gay Myths. After the broadcast today, go to the Station of the Cross. Get our resources list, download our audio as podcast. Wherever you can find audio, you can find us. Follow us on your favorite platform, write a 5-star review. We need to attract the attention of the algorithms so these conversations get the attention they deserve. Take us to your family and friends. Together, we'll take it to the whole world. Back in just 2 minutes. Please do stay with us.
This is The Catholic Current from the Station of the Cross Catholic Media Network. Catch up on an episode you've missed or share them with your family or friends. The Catholic Current is podcasted wherever you enjoy listening. Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, Stitcher, TuneIn, and the iCatholic Radio mobile app.
Praise be Jesus Christ. This is Father Robert McTague of the Society of Jesus, your daily host for the Catholic Current, where we bring Christ to the world and the world to Christ. You're listening to us from the Station of the Cross Studios, your local radio station, and the iCatholic Radio mobile app, where we proclaim the fullness of truth with clarity and charity. We're talking today with Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute. We're talking about a new ebook that's freely available from the Institute, prepared by Dr. Morse, called Protecting Your Family from the Top 5 Gay Myths. You know, we always have a family-friendly show here at the Catholic Current. This is a mature topic, so if you're listening with young ears around, you might want to wait and grab the podcast and then make a discernment for yourself whether or not it's time to share this with your young people. Dr. Morse, at the end of the last segment, we talked about the forbidden words of reparative therapy. It seems to me that what the large print giveth, the small print taketh away. You know, you can yell, my body, my choice, unless you don't want to get vaccinated. You can yell, you know, my body, my choice. But if you say, no, I don't want my child, I don't want to be mutilated, I don't think that's good for me, then somehow there's something wrong with you. So we're going to celebrate you telling your truth, unless the truth you want to tell is there's no such thing as biological determinism, and you don't have to act on your present impulses. You really do have other choices. No one dies from waiting to act on these impulses. But that's, you and I would be banned from polite society if we were on a university campus. We'd probably need a police escort and be hidden in the trunk of the car as we fled for safety. At least under the old Twitter regime, you and I would be banned. We'd lose licenses in certain states. Why is this the hill that people are willing to die on, that you can't change? And if you try to change, the only outcome can be catastrophic. Why is that the non-negotiable?
Because if it's true that people can leave the homosexual lifestyle and they can do it decisively and they can do it to their benefit and not to their harm, if that's true, then it undermines the whole born gay myth. You know, the whole you were born that way, you have no choice. It only takes one person to disprove that, right? Because the claim they're making is so strong It's like saying no woman ever regrets her abortion. Well, that's ridiculous. You only have to find one, you know, to prove that that's not true, right? And so they're making a categorical statement, which can be disproven by a single counterexample. And so they've got to suppress all these people. And there are plenty of people out there. I know some personally. I bet you do, too. People who have lived the gay lifestyle and who gave it up, who don't want to do that anymore, who don't want to live like that. They want a different circle of friends. They want a different pattern of behavior. Some of them have gone on to marry opposite sex partners. You know, I know people, I know a man, I know a woman, you know, who have been married to opposite sex partners and who have had children and been together for a long time. How much evidence would it take to convince you that they really have changed their behavior, you know, that they really are no longer gay? And so sometimes people will respond by saying, well, you weren't really gay in the first place. And I'm like, yeah, well, no, duh. You know, that kind of proves that the concept of what it means to be gay is much more fluid than you're letting on, you know. And so these people present the ex-gay, so-called, they provide a kind of counter witness to what is being promoted as if it was absolute gospel truth. And so, you know, they're like heretics.
Right. I'm glad you mentioned the spiritual aspect of that. You know, you and I are both faithful Catholics. We're trying to live what our Lord has taught. And we know that we have a spiritual enemy, Satan, who tells us that sin is inevitable. It's like a bad science fiction trope. You know, resistance is futile. You might as well give in. It's going to happen anyway. So give in and enjoy it. But that's one of the deadliest lies of the devil. And one of the things I want to talk about is how do we begin to tell people this is a spiritual battle and not just a political one or a psychological one?
Well, that's a great question. That's a really important point, especially since we as Catholics are kind of the last guys standing on this, you know. I mean, and I think it's worthwhile to point out that at one time, the entire Judeo-Christian heritage agreed that homosexual acts were not normal. Nobody ever said they were virtually normal, right? And that they were not to be encouraged. They were, in fact, they cannot be approved. I think the Catechism actually says under no circumstances can homosexual acts be approved. But never did at least in the Catholic tradition, we never said having feelings is a sin. We don't talk like that. Mm-hmm. Feelings can spring unbidden to the mind. Feelings can happen to us. It's what we choose to do or not do. Do we cultivate those feelings or do we try to resist those feelings? Do we channel those feelings? You know, do we try to diminish them? We have a long history of spiritual guidance, you could say, that tries to help people deal, particularly with temptations of the flesh, as it always used to be called, right? Which gay and straight people face. Everybody faces that, you know? So to try to break down people's resistance to sexual sin, this is a great triumph of the enemy. And that's what's going on. The whole sexual revolution is trying to tell us that we get to do anything we want sexually and nothing bad will happen to us. And nothing bad will happen socially. It's all going to be fine. All the taboos were pointless and repressive and psychologically damaging. See, that's the ultimate myth, you could say, Father, you know, that suppressing your sexual desires is bad for you. You know, and that's why so many people will say, well, are you telling gay people that they can't have sex? That's so terrible. Like they're going to die. You know, what? Nobody's ever died from not having sex. I'm pretty sure that's medically true. That's not how people die, you know?
I mean, there's certainly a great oral tradition to back that up, yeah.
Yeah, right. So for the evil one to convince us that acting on our sexual impulses without any further thought or restraint, that's a big victory for him because look at all the chaos that he's been able to sow throughout society, you know? And the ultimate object of his attack is not people who are same-sex attracted. The ultimate object of his attack is mother, father, child, the union, the family, the conjugal unit, and the love of the parents for one another and the child. The reason the evil one hates that so much is because it's an icon of Christ in the church, and that's what he's really all about. And yes. You know, the gay people are around as are sort of they're a useful tool at this right. stage of the sexual revolution, just like the trans people are a useful tool. They're like a battering ram to bang, right. bang down what's left of the restraints.
Right, right. Friends, we're speaking today with Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute. We're talking about a new ebook that they have produced called Protecting Your Family from the Top 5 Gay Myths. Dr. Morse, yes, this is a spiritual battle. Ultimately, the prize is the family, because the family yeah. is an icon of the church. And this is why there is that constant rage against the family. I mean, one of the things that I would say to folks, I said, the people who don't live what the church teaches, the people who don't live the wisdom that is inscribed in our bodies as male or female, tell me about all those happy ones. Tell me about their great families, their healthy kids, their long-lasting relationships, and tell me what their tox screening is like, and tell me about the rashes they don't have. There's very obvious side effects to this ideology that is rooted in either a misunderstanding or ultimately a hatred of the family. You have seen you've talked to a lot of people who are swimming out of the wreckage of the sexual yeah. revolution. What does this cost us? This refusal to accept natural law, this refusal to accept divine revelation. What's the price tag for that?
Oh my golly. You know, just think about family breakdown. You know, set aside the gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender portion of the sexual revolution. Just look at the impact of family breakdown. Father, not very long ago, I was a speaker at a big Catholic conference in Raleigh, North Carolina, called Ignited by Truth. A number of people there told me, by the way, that they have heard me on your radio show. Somebody said, oh, I recognize your voice.
Oh, it was because well, thanks of your be show. To God.
I know. So that, but in my talk, I talked about the three ideologies that I always talk about. In addition to the gender ideology, I always talk about the contraceptive ideology and the divorce ideology. On this occasion, I talked maybe 5 to 7 minutes about the divorce ideology, Father. And after my talk, a young lady came up to my booth with tears in her eyes. She could barely get the words out that I so appreciate what you said about divorce. Kids don't get over it. I've never heard an adult say that divorce is hard for kids. And I can't tell you how many times I have had a young person say to me, no one has ever said, I have never heard anyone else say that divorce is hard on kids. And they're always in tears. They're not sitting there telling me how great their life was with their step family or something, you know,
right.
how much they loved going back and forth between houses every weekend. That's not what they're telling me. They're telling me how hard it was and how heartbroken it was.
Oof.
And you see the same sort of thing. You know, when you see the higher rates of mental illness and psychological distress among the people who identify as gay or lesbian, and certainly the trans people, much higher rates of psychological distress amongst those people. And the final myth that I talk about in my Five Myths book, the final myth is that people experience that because society is discriminating against them. It's all about social discrimination. If we would just lighten up, if you, Father McTeague, and all you crazy Catholics would just shut up, this would all go away. They'd feel fine. Okay. It's, again, the taboos are the problem, not the underlying disconnect between our behavior and our thoughts and what is really true. Okay. And so you can dispense with that myth as well, because there have been studies that have tried to sort that out, you know. And you can see various kinds of evidence that show that even when society is very accepting, very pro-homosexual, very pro-gay, you know, discrimination is prohibited, so on and so forth, you do not see noticeable improvements in the mental health of same-sex attracted persons, okay? And so that's kind of the final dodge that they have, is to say, we'd be fine if only you would shape up. And, you know, that's a very weak, that's very thin ice to be standing on to wager the happiness of a lifetime on what I choose to do and not do, on what Father McTeague says and doesn't say.
Right.
That your happiness depends on all these other people. Most normal people don't think like that. You know, we just have to say that's not a normal thought process.
You know, I'm thinking, but I can't remember the author's name. I think he may have been a Jesuit from the Chicago province. He wrote a book called Happiness is an Inside Job. And the idea that somehow I can't be happy because other people aren't applauding me at all times. I mean, you know, Christians know this. Surely faithful Christians who are shunned precisely because they're Christian or they want to do something outrageous, you know, like pray in Latin like the saints, they're shunned, and yet they remain faithful. And friends, I want to say, yes, I know there are people who are confused. I know there are people who are struggling. I know that impulses can be very powerful. I also know that people sometimes want things that are not good for them. Real friendship and supernatural grace are things that everyone needs to live the sixth commandment well. Remember, chastity, which is right use of sexuality, regardless of your state in life, that's the universal call. It's indispensable for holiness, and with God's grace, it can be lived. Friends, when we come back, we're going to continue our conversation with Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute. We're talking about a new ebook that she's made available called Protecting Your Family from the Top 5 Gay Myths. After the broadcast today, go to thestationofthecross.com, get our resources list, download our audio as podcasts. Follow what we're following by following us on Gab. That's GAB.com. Our channel is The Catholic Current, and you can influence the conversation. Please send us your questions and comments at thestationofthecross.com/askfather. We read everything that you send us, and sometimes we adjust our shows and our lineups in response to your recommendations. Let's do this good work together. Back in just 2 minutes. Please do stay with us.
Being tempted isn't a sin. Hebrews 4 verse 15 says that Christ was tempted in all ways that we are, yet without sin. So if I'm being tempted, and then in a certain sense I'm in good company, I'm in the company of our Lord, in the company of Jesus. But what he wants me to do is actually resist those temptations as he did during his life.
That's Sermons for Everyday Living, weekdays from 6 to 7 a.m. Eastern on the Station of the Cross.
After today's broadcast, go to the Catholic Current Show page on thestationofthecross.com for info on today's guests, the show resource links, and to sign up for our weekly email of upcoming shows.
Praise be Jesus Christ. This is Father Robert McTagg of the Society of Jesus, your daily host for the Catholic Current, where we bring Christ to the world and the world to Christ. You're listening to us from the Station of the Cross Studios, your local radio station, and the iCatholic Radio mobile app, where we proclaim the fullness of truth with clarity and charity. Our returning guest today is Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute. We're talking about a new study she prepared. It's available online. We're going to link to it, called Protecting Your Family from the Top 5 Gay Myths. We always have a family-friendly show here. This is a mature topic. You might want to discern whether or not you want to listen to this with young ears around. You might want to wait and grab the audio on our podcast. Dr. Morse, I'm sure there are parents who've been worried about this, who don't even know that they're allowed to be worried about this, and they don't know what to do. They don't know where to start. What kind of encouragement can you offer concerned parents?
Well, I think that the stories of people who were once gay and who are no longer gay provide a lot of encouragement and also insight into what to do and not do. So in the ebook that you just mentioned, that you very kindly mentioned, that people can get it directly from the Ruth Institute or they can get it from you. You know, just we want everybody to have it. We have a variety of stories in there where we have kind of an excerpt from somebody's story, and then we link you to a video interview with that person so you can get a longer picture, get a more complete picture. And the very last one is a friend of mine called Charlene Cothran, who is a Black woman who was a lesbian lived a lesbian life for many years. She was brought up Baptist. She's now a Baptist minister. And she had a publication, a lesbian publication that was for Black lesbians. And she had thousands of dollars in advertising, you know, that she got every month to go with that publication. And she said, you know, when Jesus got a hold of her, And she walked away from that lifestyle. Of course, all of that disappeared. All the money disappeared. And, you know, she didn't want the magazine anymore. But, you know, her whole life changed. In the course of my interview with her, she told me about her mom and how her mom had been praying for her all the time, how her mom, after the fact, told her, honey, I knew everything you were doing. You thought you were keeping a secret from me. I knew what was going on, you know, and how her mom never gave up on her. And I hear that. I've heard that in stories. I interviewed a detransitioner who told me pretty much the same thing, you know, that my mom didn't call me by the wrong name, and she was kind of my rock of reality, even when I was at my most, you know, at my most distressed, you could say. And so I think that's a lot of encouragement for parents. You know, if you're giving your child medicine that they don't want to take, you can put up with their howling because you know you're doing the right thing for them, for example, right? Mm-hmm. When you know it's the right thing, you can press through the discomfort that you feel from their discomfort. And I think that's an important point for parents to have in their minds, you know, that you don't know the impact that you're having. They could be mad at you. They could be walking out on you. But you hang in there with love for them and with allegiance to the truth. And in the end, it's going to be okay. One way or the other, it's going to be okay.
Right. Right. You know, I have a very dear friend who's, let's say, in kind of a state of family crisis and has had to say to a child, two things you can count on. I'll never lie to you and I'll always love you.
Yeah.
You know, so I'll always tell you the truth and always love. And it's because I love you that I will insist on the truth.
Right.
And lots of great saints have said that if it's separated from truth, then it's not love.
That's right. That's exactly right. And that's one of the big lies of the evil one in our time, you know, that you can love somebody the best by lying to them, that's what love means. That's why that saying that came out through the whole debate over marriage, the definition of marriage, love is love. Love is love. Well, what kind of misleading, what a stupid thing is that to say?
You know, right.
It's meant to stop the conversation. It's not meant to deepen your understanding of anything. It's meant to steer your thoughts into a certain channel and away from certain other kind of channels, right? That love definitely is not all things called love are the same thing at all.
Yes. That's tremendously important. You know, I said, you know, love is love only to the degree that it's love. Love is wanting the best for the beloved, and
that's
the best for the beloved is God. And God being all holy cannot tolerate sin. Chastity is an indispensable ingredient in holiness. There are no exceptions to that. And I have an obligation before God, as does everyone of goodwill, to tell people, number one, chastity is not impossible. Oh my goodness, it can certainly be a struggle. There is all sorts of evidence of that. But God doesn't command the impossible. Dr. Morse, for parents who are just tuning in and who don't know the good work of the Ruth Institute, we've got about 2 minutes left in the segment. Fill us in about the Ruth Institute.
So the Ruth Institute is an international interfaith coalition to defend the family and build a civilization of love. And what that means is that we will talk to anybody who will listen, anybody who will talk to us, regardless of their faith tradition. And we're basically opposed to the whole of the sexual revolution. And we believe that traditional Christian sexual ethics protects the interests of children, as well as men and women, far better than the alternatives, because traditional Christian sexual ethics allows the most children to have a lifelong relationship with their parents, with both of their parents, right? And I think that the traditional Christian sexual ethics is defended by, supported by, consistent with the best of scientific research that shows that human beings really are relational creatures, and you can't just treat relationships like they're interchangeable or casual, something to throw away. You know, real human beings in real life need something much deeper than what the sexual revolution is offering them, and that's what we try to proclaim every day here at the Ruth Institute.
See, I think that is tremendously important. We're in a world that is so thoroughly confused, and a world that has been lied to for so long that hearing the truth is shocking. There's almost a kind of novelty. You know, my parents had my sister relatively late in life. I mean, my mother, I think, was in her mid-40s when she had my sister. So my parents were older than the parents of my sister's friends when she was growing up. And so when my sister first started going to, you know, sleepovers at girls' houses and so on, almost without exception, she'd be the only girl there working on the original set of parents.
Right.
And so this would have been in the mid to late 70s that this had happened. And I mean, God bless my parents, you know, as human as anyone, believe me, but married for 53 years. And their absolute conviction was our only option is to make it work. We'd made promises. Right. God made promises. They had a reverence for each other, and it made a lasting mark on me. Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute, God bless your good work. I'm delighted to have another stimulating, lively conversation. I would be remiss if I didn't ask, how did we get here? Because we always seem to ask that question with one another. But I look forward to our next conversation.
Well, thank you so much. And I look forward to getting better acquainted with all of your followers and listeners, as I did the other day at the conference in North Carolina. It's always great to see people who have heard me on your show. It's a lot of fun.
Oh, I am absolutely delighted to hear that. Thanks be to God. Friends, join us tomorrow. Our guest is going to be Matt Archbold of Creative Minority Report. Another cheery, upbeat topic. We're going to be talking about guess who else hates Catholics. It's a long list, and people are jostling to get to the front of the line. After the broadcast today, go to thestationofthecross.com, get our resources list, download our audio as podcasts. Wherever you can find audio, you can find us. Everything you need to take this conversation to your family and friends, we give to you. Take it to your family and friends. Together, we'll take it around the world. Send us some questions and recommendations at thestationofthecross.com/askfather. Let's do this good work together. Through the intercession of Our Lady of Mount Carmel, may Mighty God bless you, protect you from all harm and every evil to reach the happiness of heaven. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, go in peace and please do pray for me.
Thank you for listening to this podcast brought to you by thestationofthecross.com, a listener-funded nonprofit organization. Please prayerfully consider donating at thestationofthecross.com by calling 1-877-888-6279 or through our free iCatholic Radio mobile app.